Hello friends, good morning. So it's 7 a.m. in the morning and I'm recording this video. So today topic will be evolution of mobile telecommunication from first generation 1G to fifth generation 5G, which is coming now. So let's look at 1G to 5G evolution of mobile telephony. So the mobile voice communication started for the first time in 1980s. So it was first generation of mobile telecommunication. It was analog voice, and the technology which were used were AMPS, NMT and TACS. Then from 1980s to 1990s, there was 10 years gap. Then came our famous 2G, which is still running, second generation of mobile telecommunications. So this was called efficient voice to reach billions of people, and it was a digital voice. And the technology which is used for 2G is D-AMPS, GSM, IS-95 CDMA. Out of these technologies, GSM has survived even today. In many countries, 2G services are offered using the GSM technology. Then again from 1990s to 2000, in a 10 years gap came the 3G, and the focus shifted from a voice to mobile data. And we started enjoying the wireless internet, and the technologies which were approved by ITU as 3G were CDMA 2000 EVDO and WCDMA and HSPA on the GSM side. And the 3G network in India is still running by some of the operators like BSNL. Other operators have moved to the 4G services. So from 2000 to 2010, again within the span of 10 years. So what we see that every 10 years, there is a jump from one generation of mobile telephony to other generation of mobile telephony. So in 2010, 4G came, and here the focus shifted on mobile broadband, that is high speed internet on your mobile phone itself. And the technologies which were being used, or which are being used rather, is LTE, LTE Advanced, and now Gigabit LTE. So again, from 2010 to 2020, the focus is moving from 4G to 5G, and 5G is being said as a unified future-proof platform. So this will give very, very high speed internet. You can see my video on 5G introductions, wherein I have given detail of 5G. And we also see the wireless edge kind of services coming up because of the 5G architecture, and it has got a new radio. So variety of services it will offer, for example, enhanced mobile broadband, ultra reliable low latency kind of services, and massive machine type communication like IoT and sensors. And it can operate from sub 1 gigahertz frequency to millimeter wave, and will be using MIMO and beam forming kind of technologies, small cell, to achieve all these requirements. So now let us look at the network diagram of 2G, second generation mobile telecommunications. So we all know that we have a mobile device, and it has got SIM. Now on the radio part, if you see here, so you have base stations, we see towers. So base stations antennas are installed at tower, and on the below tower you have BTS, and the BTSs are connecting to base station controller BSC, and the entire system is called BSS. And then if you move towards core side, core network you have MSC, Mobile Switching Center, which connects all the BSCs. Then you have GMSC, Gateway MSC, which connects to outside network like PSTN. You have HLR, Home Location Register, where detail of all the subscribers are stored. And then you have VLR, Visitor Location Register, all the roaming subscribers details are kept here. So primarily 2G network is a circuit switched network. And even on the radio side, it uses time division multiplexing. For every mobile call, there is a specific time slot allotted, and that allotment continues till call is continuing. So that means there is a dedicated voice channel even on the radio, and of course that will continue onto the MSC and beyond. So primarily 2G is a circuit switched network. Now let us look at 3G network, how it evolved from 2G to 3G. So if you look at here, it is mobile station or your mobile phone, so it is similar, same. But on the radio side, so this is called now radio access network, and you have node 1, node 2, so these are base stations. So now base stations are now being called node 1. In 2G it was being called BTS, and the BSC is being called as a radio network controller. So names have changed, but this is equivalent to BSC. On the core side there is a difference. So the core is having two parts. One is a circuit switch domain, which is similar or same to the 2G network. In addition, a packet core network has been introduced. So that is a packet switch domain. So now all the voice call will continue to be handled on the circuit switch domain, but all the data calls or the internet data or any other kind of data will flow through packet switch domain. So let us discuss. So on the packet switch domain side, you have SGSN, which is an interface towards radio network controller. It also does mobility management, session management, and other functions. The other component is GGSN, which is a gateway towards outside IP network like IMS. So you see that we have circuit switch domain and also packet switch domain in 3G network. Let us look at evolution of 3G network to 4G network. What are the changes were made? So if you look at 3G network, you had circuit core and also the packet core. Circuit core for voice call and packet core for data. So when it evolved to 4G network, the circuit core was removed and only packet core remained. And HLR was kind of renamed as HSS, Home Subscriber Server. And even the voice call, which earlier used to be handled in a circuit core, is being handled in the packet core itself. And for that, you will require a separate network node called IMS. So IMS helps control the voice call or enable the voice call onto the 4G network. And that's why we call it voice over LTE, VoLTE, because the network itself is called LTE, so voice over LTE, and it's a completely IP voice. And then packet core also connects to IP network or any services it offers. The other change which you notice is that normally from RAN to core, RAN to RNC, there was a T1 backhaul, but normally T1 backhaul, but in 4G, as it has to handle more data compared to 3G, so it will be a fiber or Ethernet kind of backhaul to the core. So let us look at a slightly detailed network diagram of 4G. So you have user equipment, LTE user equipment, and then you have E node B. So if you recall 2G or 3G, you had BTS, you had BSC. Now these are combined into a single entity called E node B. So it is BTS and BSC combined together on the radio side, and this radio is called EUTRON. Now on the core side, this is called Enhanced Packet Core, EPC. It will consist of various network elements like MME. This is Mobility Management Entity, which is responsible for mobility management, session management, and also it connects UE for NAS signaling. It also does some connection management, bearer management, etc. On the user plane side, where data traffic flows, so the data traffic will flow from UE to E node B to serving gateway to PDN gateway to the IP network or any other network like IMS, internet, or any apps. So user plane goes like this, user plane data, and rest are for managing mobility and other control functions. So basically, the upper part is the pure control plane, whereas the lower part is primarily user plane, but it also does some control plane function. So now let's look at serving gateway. So serving gateway connects to the E node B for user plane data, and PDN gateway connects to the outside IP network on SGI interface. So all the data towards IP network goes through PDN gateway. So as the name suggests, this is gateway towards IP network, and serving gateway is gateway towards E node B. Now let us look at various interfaces which is used in 4G network. So the interface, radio interface between mobile and the E node B is called UU interface, and the interface, user plane interface between E node B to serving gateway, which is primarily for data traffic, the actual data traffic flows here, so that is called S1U. And then you have interface between serving gateway and PDN gateway, S5 or SET, and then you have SDI interface to IP network from PDN. So if you look at HSS, we had discussed that this is home subscriber server, so all the subscriber informations are kept here, and we have PCRF policy, charging function, policy and charging function. So this is how a 4G network looks like. Now let us look at high level 5G system. So you have UE, user equipment, that is mobile, 5G mobile. And the radio part is called NG-RAN, New Generation Radio Access Network. And then you have core, so that is called 5G core. And then it connects to data network. So in 4G, this was being called packet data network, where in 5G, it is just called data network, but because it can have any kind of data network, not only the packet data network. Even the structured data is supported in 5G. So the entire thing is called 5G system. So let us look at 5G system in slightly detailed architecture. So you have UE, and then you have G node B, that is your node B E node B in 4G, here it is called G node B, and then you have user plane function, and then you have data network. So the actual data traffic from mobile to a data network will be flowing from UE to Z node B to user plane function to the data network, and rest all are to support this traffic flow. So let us discuss one by one what are these different network elements in very brief. So you have AMF, that is access and mobility functions. This is called core access and mobility function. So the UE also gets connected to AMF on N1 interface, of course through G node B. So although interface is shown directly, but it is through G node B only. G node B transparently passes this interface to AMF. So all the access authorization and mobility management is done by AMF. Now let us talk about SMF. This is session management function. So as 5G is a pure data network, I mean the entire traffic is data, whether it is voice or internet or any kind of services on data. So the creation of session or modification of session or altering of session is done by SMF. And this is called PDU session. Protocol data unit session is established by SMS for UE to make data traffic or the traffic, any kind of traffic it has. And of course, user plane functions enables the UE for this data flow, and user plane function is kind of an anchor point for UE when it moves from one G node B to other G node B. Now let us talk about UDM. This is called Unified Data Management. This is almost equivalent to HSS in 4G network. So Unified Data Management will have profile of all the subscriber, what services they are allowed, etc. It also contains profile of data network. So there could be many type of data network connected for different services. So this will also have profile of data network, and which data network can be assigned to which user is also written here. And UDM also does some security related function, like if subscriber is to be authenticated, so all those security mechanism is done by UDM. Of course you have authentication function also, which is not shown here. And then you have policy and charging function, PCF, for all policy and charging rules is provided by PCF. So this is in nutshell the 5G architecture, and this is called reference point architectures. There is one more architecture which will actually be used in 5G or actually being used in 5G, that I'll just be discussing. So before I move to 5G service based architecture, I just wanted to compare the 4G core network with 5G core network, and which network is equivalent to which network element in 4G. So for example, MME in 4G, Mobility Management Entity in 4G, is now broken into two parts, access and mobility function and session management functions. So both these functions were being done by MME in 4G network. Now, user plane function in 5G has taken user plane part of the function from serving gateway and from PDN gateway. So that means serving gateway and PDN gateway is merged into UPF, but only the user plane part, control plane part, are not merged into the UPF. Policy and control function in 5G is equivalent to PCRF, policy control, policy and charging rule function. in 4G. And of course, authentication function was there in, so HSS was also doing authentication in case of 4G, which is now being done by AUSF, which we'll discuss in the service-based architecture. And part of the HSS function is also in the UDM, Unified Data Management. Now, if you look at application function, it was there in the 4G, although I had not shown in the simplified diagram, but application functions are there. And then in service-based architecture, you have some network element called network exposure function, which is a new in 5G. This is used to connect any third-party system on API to 5G network. And NRF is network repository function. This is also a new element. So since it is a service-based architecture, an API-based interaction will happen between the node. So the discovery of the node will be done by NRF. And then you have very important network element called NSSF, network slice selection function, which is also new. So the 5G network can be broken into various slices to offer various kind of services. For example, for enhanced mobile broadband, we'll have a separate slice. So it will have a different quality of service requirement. The ultra reliable, low latency kind of services like autonomous car, self-driving, or the remote surgery by a doctor, we can have a separate slice of the network which will handle this ultra reliable and low latency kind of services. Similarly, there will be a slice for sensors, etc., that we call it massive mobile type communications. And there could be n number of slices for different purpose. There could be a slice for a specific corporate also, one can create and allocate. So there is a concept of slicing the end-to-end network of 5G. And now finally, let us look at 5G service-based architecture. So what has happened, from a point-to-point architecture, we have moved to a service-based architecture. So if you see this, this is the control plane function group, and all the network element, network functions in this are connected onto a bus and they talk to each other on API. And the user plane is separated out, completely separated out, and the user plane function will normally reside near to the traffic or resident itself. So it is a kind of distributed. So UPF will, so the core can be centralized, but user plane function will be distributed across the network. And as you see, as I had explained, I have already explained access and mobility function. I have explained session management function. I have explained user plane functions. We have seen ZNodeB mobile and how it connects to the data network. So let me just tell you the new network element. So as I have explained, this is network slice selection functions, network exposure function for exposing the API to outside third party to connect to the 5G network, network repository functions, discovery of all the node is done by this. So suppose one network element talk to other network element, so it discovers that network through the NRF. So if a suppose new instance of any network element is created, so NRF will have address of that. So other network element can just ping to NRF and discover that network, and then they can make an API call. So it has become a flat architecture. This is AF application function has been kept outside this. This could be IMS, this could be any edge type of application and all. Let us look at the user plane side. So on user plane side, all the data traffic flows from UE to ZNodeB to user plane function and then to the data network of any description. And the interfaces, if you look at, so interface from mobile to ZNodeB, it talks to MF on N1 interface, of course, through this, and ZNodeB talks to MF on N2 interface. ZNodeB to UPF is called N3 interface, and UPF to N6 is called UPF to data network interface is N6. So on N6 interface, data network gets connected, and to SMF, UPF is connected on N4 interface. And on the control panel, there is no point-to-point interface, it is API-based interface. So this is what I wanted to discuss with you, and I have made a detailed presentation on the core network. You can see my video in the channel if you want to go more detail onto the 5G network architecture. So thank you for listening to seeing my video on 1G to 5G evolution of mobile telecommunications. So please help me and help others by subscribing my channel. So if you subscribe my channel, you get a notification whenever I upload a new video on any topic. Please like the video and also share the link of the video with your friends. You can make the link of my video as your status on WhatsApp, Facebook, etc. And if you use other social media, you can post video link of this particular session. If you write a blog, you can write a blog about my video. And then finally, please let me know if you want me to make video on any other topic, other tech topic, particularly on telecommunications. So with this, let me thank you for listening. So thank you. You can connect me on my Gmail, which is ashokumar100@gmail.com. Please note that there is a single K in between, Ashok Kumar. So there is a single K in between. So finally, namaskar and bye for now. Let's see you in the next video.